Welcome back students to another class of geography. In the last class we had already started chapter number 1 and we have completed certain features, certain aspects or certain concepts of this chapter. In the last chapter we saw the definition of a topographical map. We saw many of the color schemes, colors like blue, red, green, isn't it? We saw all these things. In this class, we are going to study about the settlements. Here, in this chapter, in this class, we are going to study the types of settlements. In the last class, while studying the color schemes, we had come across color red, isn't it? We had studied a color called red. In while studying the color red, I said you that whenever a red color is shown on a topo sheet, it indicates that settlements are there. Settlement means houses, buildings, isn't it? Recall the last class. In the last class, I showed you a topo sheet, and in that topo sheet, there was a place called Gulab Ganj. Ganj means market area, and that Ganj, Gulab Ganj, was having a red dots or your indication of the red color. And I said that means if red color is there, it means that place has buildings, houses, settlements. So in this class we are going to study about the types of the settlements. What are the kinds of the, what types of settlements are there? So first one among that is nucleated settlement. First settlement we are going to study here is nucleated settlements. Nucleated settlements. What does that mean? I'll show you. In nucleated settlement, what happens is the houses or the buildings are very close to each other. The houses or the buildings are very close, very compact in nature. Such settlements, we call it as nucleated settlements. See here, this is an indication of a house. I cannot draw a house here, a symbol of a house. So we symbolically use a circular symbol. So when the houses are close to each other, such settlements, we call it as nucleated settlements. See, there are no difference between the two houses. There is no space between the two houses, isn't it? Such settlement is called as nucleated settlement. So then the next question comes up. Why the houses are so close to each other? What are the reasons or the conditions that are necessary for the nucleated settlements to come up? Think, what may be the reason for the nucleated settlements to come up? The first reason may be, the first reason is that, reason number one. The first reason is, the land is a plain area. The land is plain in nature. It's a plain area. That is the first reason. By plain area here mean this land does not have any highlands or mountains. It's a plain area. When the area is plain, we can construct houses very closely, isn't it? Imagine if there are valleys or mountains nearby. In the valleys or the mountains, can we construct the houses very closely? Is that possible? No. That is not the condition. So here the land is plain, here the area is plain in nature. So the houses has been constructed very closely. That is the first reason. What is the reason number two? The reason number two is population in the area must, population is large. Population is large. Second is population is large in this area. If population is large, it's not practical. It's not possible to construct the houses very far up, isn't it? When population is high in any country, any state, any district or any place, what happens at such time is the land becomes a prized possession, isn't it? The value of the land increases because the land is scarce and the people who want to settle on that land are many. So at that time, the prices of the land also becomes very high. And the third one is the agriculture in that region must be prosperous enough. Agriculture is prosperous. That means it's fertile area. Not prosperous, I can write fertile. So, when land is fertile, agriculture will be good because this area must have agricultural prosperity because first thing it is a plain area. For example, northern plains of India, in northern plains of India, we can find such compact settlements. Second one, in the plain area, usually the land will be very fertile. And when the land is fertile, that means the agricultural prosperity will be there in such areas. Hope you understood it. Examples of where we can see the this kind of compact settlement. Example is, as said earlier, northern plains of India have this compact kind of settlement. Apart from northern plains, coastal plains, we can find this. Nowadays, not only in these areas, in almost all the metropolitan cities, the population is so much that it's very difficult to build the houses very far off, isn't it? In cities like Delhi, Mumbai, or for that matter, Bengaluru. In such areas, in such cities also, we find the houses are very nearby. That is only because that the area has high population. The next, this was all about the nucleated settlement. The next settlement we are going to study is, the second settlement is dispersed settlement. Dispersed, what is the meaning of disperse? Dispersed settlement. This is the second one. Meaning of disperse is far off, not too close, isn't it? So let's see how this dispersed settlement first looks. In case of dispersed settlements, the houses are far off. In case of dispersed settlements, houses are far off. Compare compact settlement with dispersed settlement. See here, there is a much gap between the settlements, isn't it? There is a much gap between the settlements here. But in case of nucleated, there was no such gap. houses were very close to each other. So this is how the dispersed settlement looks. The next one, why the dispersed settlements come up? What are the reasons or the features for that? The first reason is the area has a plains. The area has mountains. That is the first reason. Highlands. If the area has mountains, highlands, etc., in such areas we find this dispersed settlement. Imagine, see here, the area has many valleys, many mountains. Then how to construct the houses close by? There are no such space or no area that I can construct the house very closely. But that was not the case in case of the nucleated settlement. In case of nucleated settlement, the area was plain. You could construct the houses wherever you felt like. But when we have the mountains and highlands, such is not the case. Only in this valley place we can construct a house. Only in this valley place houses can be constructed. So the next where I can construct the house is in the next valley. So obviously the houses cannot be nearby, isn't it? The second reason is, reason number two is, population is very sparse in this region. Population is not too high. Population is very sparse, very little. When population is very little, the question will not arise that many houses will come up. When population is limited, for example, the population of the area is, what to say, 100. Just 100. Example, I'm giving you the example. If the population is 100, how many houses may come up? At the most, 25 houses. Because in this population includes the many families. Father, mother, brothers, isn't it? In one family, four or five members will be there. So by that logic, only 25 houses may come up. But in case of nucleated settlement, here let's take the population is 1 lakh. Population is 1 lakh. So how much I can say? 50,000 or 60,000 houses will come up. That is the difference between the nucleated settlement and the dispersed settlement. And which occupation can be said here? Here, animal rearing is the main occupation. Animal rearing is the main occupation. Animal husbandry, we call it off. Like, that is the main occupation in the dispersed, nearby the dispersed settlements. Why? Because when you have the highlands or the mountains or the valleys in such areas, as we cannot conduct the agricultural activities, in those areas we cannot grow wheat, rice or something. So people need some occupation to survive. People need some occupation to carry on their livelihoods, isn't it? So animal rearing is the important occupation in this area. I hope now you can clearly demarcate the difference between the nucleated settlements and the dispersed settlements. The kind of the pattern of the settlement, the area, the population, I hope everything is clear. The last settlement in the settlement is of linear settlement. So the next type of settlement is linear settlements, also called as ribboned settlement or ribbon settlement. Now see, in case of the linear settlement, this is a way, right? A straight line is there, or a path is there, and around this path settlement comes up. Around this path the settlement has come up. This path may be a river bank or a railway line. Around such areas we can find linear type of settlements or linear settlements. Why? Again a question comes up, why such type of settlements, or the reasons for these kinds of settlements to come up. The first reason, as said, is the area must be having a river banks. Around river banks, around railway lines, we can find, or along important roads, or along roads we find, etc., we find these kinds of settlements. For example, if I consider this as a river, on the banks of the river these settlements have come up. On the banks of the river these settlements have come up. Or consider this as a railway line. Consider this as a railway line. Settlements have come up over here. And the settlements are not as thick as nucleated settlements. The settlements are not as close as nucleated settlements here. Next reason is, these settlements come up near the industrial areas or the industrial towns. Industrial areas or industrial towns. Such kinds of settlements we can find near the industrial towns, because it becomes very convenient for the industries to unload and load their commodities or the materials. Isn't it? In almost all in the northern Indian cities like Kanpur and all these things, all those areas, these kinds of settlements are common. Even along the river banks, or even in the coastal areas where the harbor or port is nearby, near the port cities also linear settlements can come up. Next one, what can be the occupation? What is the occupation? In case of dispersed, it was animal rearing. In case of nucleated settlement, the occupation was agriculture. What can be the occupation of the people residing over here? It can be agriculture, because river banks are nearby, or if the area has railway lines or near the roadside, agriculture occupation will be something related to industry itself. Occupation will be something related to industry. Occupation may be related to the manufacturing sector. So this was all about the three kinds of the settlements and the differences between the settlements. The next we are going to study is about the scales. So the next important topic of this chapter is scale. I know we already know about the scale. We use the scales for the measurement purpose, isn't it? The same is case when we are making a map. We are studying the scales in relation to the maps today, because the chapter is about the topographical map. So while preparing a map also, scales are required. Scale is required. So map is about the calculations. Map is about the calculation. So the scale is essential to measure the distance between the two places. Scale is essential, isn't it? So the scale what we use there and what we are going to study here is bit different. Let's try to understand this. First, so while representing a map, for example, the distance between Dharwad and Bangalore, or the distance between Dharwad and Bangalore is almost 425 kilometers. It's almost 425 kilometers. The distance between these two places is 425 kilometers. But in the map, I cannot show the 425 kilometers, isn't it? It is highly impractical to show 425 kilometers between the two places. Then, how to do this? Then, how to show? First, let's study what is the definition of a scale. Scale is the ratio between, scale is the ratio between distance measured on the map. Scale is the ratio between distance on the map to distance, corresponding distance on the ground or the earth. Distance on the ground or earth. This is the definition of a scale. Scale is the ratio between distance on the map and distance on the ground. It is a ratio between the two. Why we are using the ratio system here? Because map is all about the reductions. Map is all about the reduction. If the distance between Dharwad and Bangalore is 425 kilometers, I cannot show 425 kilometers on the map. I have to reduce the distance. How to reduce the distance now? To reduce the distance, we have two kinds of scales. First scale we are going to study is linear scale. The first type of scale is linear scale. This linear scale is one of the easiest scales. Open your atlas and see on the right hand corner, they usually give a scale 1 centimeter to 10 kilometer. Usually this is the scale which is given in the atlas. What does that mean? 1 centimeter to 10 kilometer. What does that mean? That means that if on the map it is 1 centimeter, the place is shown as 1 centimeter on the map, it means on the ground the place is 10 kilometers. The place is 10 kilometers. That is the meaning of this. 1 centimeter to 10 kilometer, or 1 inch to 50 miles. This is the easiest form of the scale that we can show. Now let's construct the scale. Let's construct a linear scale. What is the scale measurement we are taking here? Here for this scale I am taking the linear measurement as, for 1 centimeter we are showing it as 250 kilometers. We are showing it as 250 kilometers. Now let's start from 0, right? 0, 1. Here I am writing 1. What does that mean? 1 centimeter. On the upper hand side, I will be writing 1 centimeter. On below, it means the value. Here it means 250 kilometers. Next one is 2 centimeter. Add up 250. Next one 250, it is 500. Next is 3 centimeter. That means 750 kilometer. Next one is 4 centimeter. 750 plus 250. 1000. Next one, 5 centimeter. That means 1250. The next scale is 6 centimeter. 1500 kilometer. This is the way to construct a linear scale. First, we have converted, we have taken 1 centimeter means 250 kilometers on the map. So, it is 1 centimeter here. That means on the ground, this place is 250 kilometers. Let me take now example. The earlier example what I gave. Example, the earlier example what I gave between Dharwad and Bangalore. Right? I said the distance between Dharwad and Bangalore is 425 kilometers. Now, how to understand in this linear scale? So, in the linear scale, they have shown that 1 centimeter means 250 kilometer, 2 centimeters means 500 kilometers. So, the distance between Dharwad to Bangalore must be between this, between 1 and 2 centimeter, the distance will be shown. Right, maybe 1.75 or 1.8, we can show on the map that between Dharwad and Bangalore, this much is there. Understood the concept of the linear scale. The next scale is representative fraction. So, the next scale is representative fraction. This is the second type of scale which is used in map measurement. This representative fraction, this representative scale, we every time we find it this in topo sheets. In topo sheets, this type of representative scale can be found, but whereas linear scale can be found in our atlas or maps, isn't it? Linear scale can be found in the atlas or the maps we use, but this representative scale is usually found in this type of measurement is used while preparing the topo sheets. So let's understand what does this representative fraction means. Representative fraction means distance on the map divided by distance on the ground. Because in reality, we cannot take the distance on the ground as it is on the map. If the distance is 500 kilometers or 1000 kilometers in reality, I cannot take while preparing that, I cannot show 1000 kilometers on a topo sheet. So, there must be a reduction in the scale, and this is one of the methods for the reduction. On the top we write distance on the map, and on the this one denominator side we write distance on the ground, and it is the measurement must be the same, unit of measurement must be the same to convert the fraction, isn't it? It is same in your fractions also. While doing the mathematical fractions, unit of measurement must be the same, else we cannot convert it, right? So here they have given a problem to solve. To convert a statement to representative fraction, here they have given convert 5 centimeter to 1 kilometer on representative fraction. Now we have to convert 5 centimeter to 1 kilometer in representative fraction. Now how to convert? Because units of measurement are different. Here centimeter is there and here kilometer is there. How to convert it? The first step for conversion is convert the units of measurement. Now, what I have to convert? 1 kilometer, isn't it? I have to convert 1 kilometer. So, here I am converting 1 kilometer. That means 1 kilometer is equal to, I have to convert kilometer into centimeter. 1 kilometer is equal to how much? 1 lakh centimeters. 1 kilometer is equal to 1 lakh centimeters. Now, both the units of measurement are same. Centimeter, centimeter. Now let's put this in the formula we have. Distance on the map. Distance on the map is 5 centimeter. Distance on the map is 5 centimeter. 5 centimeter I have written here. Divided by distance on the ground. Distance on the ground is 1 lakh. Distance on the ground is 1 lakh. How to understand that which one is the map distance and which one is the ground distance? How to demarcate while a problem is given? Obviously, centimeter is a map distance because we are using the technique of reduction. It's very easy to show centimeter on a map rather than kilometer. Kilometer is impractical to be shown on a map. So that means when centimeter is there, that means that is the map distance. When kilometer is there, it is the ground distance. So we have given it in our this one formula, 5 by 1 lakh. Now further reduce it. 1 by 5 twos are 10, right? Reduce it. 20,000. So representative fraction is 1:20,000. This is representative fraction. See how we have converted. Earlier they had given 5 centimeter to 1 kilometer. And now we have successfully converted that into the representative fraction. How? We converted the kilometer into centimeter so that the units of measurement between the two will be the same. After that, on the given formula, we substituted these numbers. So finally, the representative fraction is 1:20. In the next class, we will study about the distance measurement. So the last part here is about the homework. Write the following. I've given 3: nucleated settlement, dispersed, and the linear settlement. You have to write about nucleated. In which kind of area we do find these settlements, the reasons, along with the diagram. The area, the occupation of the people, the population. These things you have to describe while writing the settlements. As I've already explained about this, you can easily write it, no problem. Along with the diagram, write the homework in your homework book. Thank you.